talk today about a very unusual sort of cancer, but one that has a good chance of driving an entire species to extinction within the next 20 years. I'm sure for most of us, everything we know or think we know about Tasmanian devils, we learned on Saturday morning cartoons. But what I hope you noticed in the previous slide was that, in fact, they're a whole lot cuter than this. And they're also considerably smaller and more docile than you may ever have imagined. These marsupials got their name from the European settlers to the island of Tasmania off the coast of Australia because the Europeans thought of them as very aggressive hunters and because they make terrifying noises at night. In fact, these animals are not hunters. They are solitary nocturnal scavengers. They do, however, have a pugnacious side to them in that they engage in very ferocious fights with each other while they're mating and also while they're fighting over food. Nonetheless, these fights very rarely result in mortal wounds. Until recently, there was no reason to think that these animals were in any way threatened. In fact, you might think that they were actually at the top of their game, evolutionarily speaking. They're at the top of the food chain in the Tasmanian ecosystem. They're well adapted to their environment. However, since the early 2000s, their numbers have dropped precipitously because of this unusual cancer. And experts predict that unless there is some successful intervention, they will be extinct by the year 2035. So the story I want to tell you begins with these fights, during which these Tasmanian devils bite each other on the face. And starting fairly recently, these bites have been observed to result in the formation of tumors. These tumors can be disfiguring, even grotesque. In fact, I've spared you the most graphic images, which you're welcome to go look up online yourself. These tumors are invariably fatal to these animals, either because they grow so big that the animals can't eat, because the animals get secondary infections, or because the tumors actually metastasize to other parts of the body, the lungs or the heart or whatever, and result in organ failure. So the first facial tumor was reported in 1996, and at this point, 70% of the Tasmanian devils in Tasmania are infected. That's caused great alarm among conservation biologists. It's also caused alarm among the government officials in Australia because the Tasmanian devil is rather a mascot for the Tasmanian tourist industry. But most importantly for this talk, it's caused intrigue among cancer biologists. Because if you think about it, we don't normally think of cancer as being a contagious disease. You don't worry when you care for someone or come in contact with someone who has cancer that you are going to contract cancer. So what I want to do, just as my students and I did in my infectious disease tutorial class, is explore how researchers investigate something as odd as a contagious cancer. And so we might need to start by thinking about what do we know about cancer in general. So cancer arises when a cell makes an inappropriate decision to divide. Normally, our cells keep their growth and division very tightly controlled, and we understand some, although not all, of the ways that those cells know to control their cell division. A tumor occurs when a cell has made a bad decision to go on dividing even when it shouldn't. Those normal breaks on cell division are encoded in the DNA. And so if we want to understand what's going on in this cancer, perhaps we should think about the DNA of these cells. And that is exactly what researchers did. So in 2012, researchers took the DNA from a healthy Tasmanian devil, and they also took DNA from two different tumor cells. And they sequenced the entire genome of those DNA samples. And that allowed them to compare the DNA of the normal cells with the DNA of the tumor cells. And they looked for individual differences in the A's, G's, C's, and T's that make up the DNA. And they didn't find a single obvious difference between these DNA samples. In fact, they found 17,000 differences. Now, to put that in perspective, a normal human cancer might also have 5,000 or more differences from a normal, healthy cell. At the same time, other researchers looked at the chromosomes in these tumors. So you may know of chromosomes as long strings of DNA. They're the way that we package and organize the DNA in our cells. You've probably heard of the X chromosome and the Y chromosome. You may know that humans have 46 chromosomes, if you were paying attention just recently on the video. Marsupials, like the Tasmanian devil, have 7 pairs of chromosomes, and we can paint the individual chromosomes different colors. And that allows us to ask, are these chromosomes intact? Or in fact, has there been some change in the chromosome structure? And what you can see in this figure is that in these tumors, in fact, there has been a lot of whole-scale moving of chromosomal fragments. So that here, chromosome 2 has bits of chromosome 1 and the X chromosome. Likewise, chromosome 6 has a bit of the X chromosome. And then you've got these kind of totally funky chromosomes over here that are just kind of an amalgam of all different bits of genetic information. It's almost like when you, at the end of editing a large body of text, you've not only changed words, you've not only changed individual letters, you've moved whole paragraphs around. And that's what's happened in these tumor cells. Again, this is not atypical for cancer cells. But it might lead you to question how you could possibly begin to understand cancer if you're having all these dramatic changes in the DNA. In fact, these experiments, along with some other earlier experiments, led to a critical insight about this cancer in this Tasmanian devil. And to help you appreciate that insight, let's think again about what we know about cancer typically. I said that cancer arises when the DNA changes so that the controls on cell division aren't carried out normally. So we might ask, well, how do those changes normally happen in a normal cancer? Some changes are hereditary. So we think about the breast cancer gene. We think about someone who has a history of colon cancer in their family. Other cancers arise because of environmental exposure. So too much sunlight can lead to skin cancer. Exposure to tobacco smoke can lead to lung cancer. Or, to paraphrase Shakespeare, some cells are born bad, other cells have badness thrust upon them. What we might not appreciate as much, but certainly plays a critical role in cancer as well, are things like lifestyle and dietary choices. And finally, certain viral infections can also cause cancer. You may have heard of HPV, human papillomavirus, which causes cervical cancer. There are certain types of hepatitis infections that can lead to liver cancer. But what all these cancers have in common is that it's your own cell that has made that bad decision to start dividing. In these Tasmanian devils, something very different is going on because, in fact, these cancers are acquired from a donor animal that is infected. So when one Tasmanian devil has a tumor on its face, as it bites another animal, those tumor cells slough off, they lodge themselves in those wound sites, and then they grow to be tumors in a matter of months in that recipient animal. And that's almost unheard of, that you would catch cancer from something else. In fact, there's only 2 well-characterized examples, one of them being this devil facial tumor, and the other being a venereal tumor in dogs that is passed through sexual intercourse. So we might ask, how are researchers so sure that this is really passed from person or from animal to animal? How do we know that it's not a virus that's getting passed that then causes the tumor secondarily? Well, again, if we think about a normal cancer, suppose that I get lung cancer. The cells in that tumor in my lung have my DNA. If Jim ends up getting lung cancer as well, the cells in his tumor have his DNA, not my DNA. But in these transmissible cancers, in fact, the cells in the cancer are not my cells. They don't have my DNA. And again, we can see that by looking at the chromosomes in these tumors. So once again, we have the normal chromosomes from a healthy animal up here, again, 7 pairs of them. And here we have 4 different tumors. And again, we've seen that the chromosomes in these tumors are very different. There's missing chromosomes, there's extra chromosomes. Although these chromosomes aren't all identical to each other in these 4 tumor samples, they are much more similar to each other than they are to a healthy animal. The same is true in the dog venereal cancer. So we can depict genetic relatedness as a sort of tree diagram like this, where the little twigs on the end of the branches are breeds of dogs that are very closely related to each other. And the length of the branch indicates how distantly related they are, a longer branch meaning more distantly related. So here we have the Shih Tzus and the Pekingese very close to each other, but very far away from the Huskies and the Malamutes. The wolves are down here all by themselves on a separate branch. And look where the dog venereal tumors are. They're way over by themselves. They're very closely related to each other and very distantly related to the dogs that host them. In fact, in a study of 40 different tumors from 40 different dogs on 5 continents, researchers found that every one of those tumors was derived from a single ancestral cell that made a bad decision to divide. And that cell made a bad decision to divide 6,000 years ago. And it made a bad decision because of a change in its DNA, as shown in this slide. And since that time, those cancerous cells have passed through 30,000 different dogs, being passed from dog to dog to dog to dog. It's the oldest known living cell line. So what does this transmissible cancer in dogs perhaps tell us about the similar case in the Tasmanian devils? Well, at first glance, you might think, actually, based on what I've told you, not all that much. Because, first of all, I've told you that the dog cancer is very ancient, the devil cancer is very recent. I've told you that the mode of transmission is different. And perhaps most strikingly, the dog cancer is very rarely lethal, whereas the Tasmanian devil cancer is invariably lethal. Again, just to give you a sense of the impact on these Tasmanian devils, an average Tasmanian devil in the wild will live to be 5 or 6 years old, typically. However, these days, if you survey populations of Tasmanian devils in the wild, you will rarely find an animal more than 3 years old, because in fact, all those animals have died after 1 or 2 years because of this cancer. So clearly, we have an urgent need to figure out what's going on with this cancer and to eradicate it before it eliminates this entire species. One avenue of investigation that has given us some insight builds on what we know about how bodies normally try to protect themselves from infected cells as well as from cancer. So in our immune system, we have something called T cells. And T cells' jobs are to recognize and to destroy infected cells as well as cancerous cells. They do that by binding to an infected cell, producing toxins called perforins that make holes or perforations in the target cell. And those perforations result in those cells bursting and being destroyed. It's just like taking a balloon and popping it with a bunch of pins all at once. Now, how does the T cell know that this is an infected cell or a cancer cell and not a normal cell that should be left alone? Well, cancer cells make proteins that normal cells don't make. We can think of those as markers for a cancer cell. And every cell makes a protein called MHC. And the job of the MHC is to present those markers to the T cell so that the T cell knows this is a cell that I should attack. So why then doesn't the T cells and the immune response take care of these infected, contagious, cancerous cells? Well, in the case of the dog cancer, we know that, in fact, the progression of the disease is such that in the beginning, the immune system doesn't take care of them. When the dogs are first infected, they form tumors for the first 3 to 9 months, and the tumors progress precisely because the immune system is not doing anything about them. But then after that time, the tumors begin to stabilize or even regress. And that correlates exactly with what's happening to the MHCs. In those first few months, those cancer cells don't make MHC proteins. Once they start to make the MHC proteins, the immune system cuts in and gets the upper hand. So really, there's a balance between the progression of the tumor and the immune system. Now, what about in the venereal, contagious cancer in the Tasmanian devils? Well, until recently, researchers had actually focused on a rather different sort of story. And that story has to do with MHC diversity. So I've mentioned this MHC protein. It turns out that MHC comes in many, many flavors. That's shown in this slide here, different colored MHC proteins. And which MHC proteins your cells make is determined by which MHC genes you inherited from your mother and your father. The diversity is rather remarkable, incredibly strikingly large repertoire of possible MHC proteins. Just to give you some sense, in the human, just for this MHC A gene, there are 2,000 possible MHC A genes you could have. For the B gene, 2,500 possible genes, and for the C gene, another 1,300 possible genes. The combination of MHCs that are on your cells is completely different than the combination of MHC proteins on the cells of the person sitting next to you. This is, in fact, the basis for incompatibility during organ transplantation, because your immune system is primed to see your own MHCs as self and to reject any cells that don't have the same combination of MHCs. So why, then, doesn't the immune system take care of a contagious cancer when cells are coming in with different MHCs? Well, it turns out that for the Tasmanian devils, there actually isn't a great diversity of MHCs. And that actually makes sense if you think about these animals. They live on an island that's very geographically isolated. They are not found anywhere other than Tasmania, and they've been very inbred over all the time they've lived in Tasmania. And so particularly for the animals on this eastern half of this island, they have the same MHC. There is no diversity. And so that makes all the sense in the world then that a cancer that arose up here in the northeast corner could be passed on and would not be rejected by the other animals on the eastern half of the island because, in fact, the MHCs are identical. They're not seen as foreign. There was hope that, in fact, the animals in the northwest corner would be safe because those animals have a slightly different MHC, and it was thought that that disease would not be able to cross that immune barrier. However, we now know that that's not true. Recently, the disease has crossed that immune barrier, and the animals in the northwest corner have also gotten sick despite not having the same MHC profile. So what is going on there? Well, just a few months ago, researchers discovered that in the Tasmanian devil cancer cells, the story is actually much more similar than one might have thought to what's going on in the dogs. That is to say, the MHC protein fails to move to the surface. And if it can't move to the surface, it can't present those cancer markers, and the T cells don't know to eliminate those cancerous cells. These researchers also gave us some hope that we might be able to develop a vaccine, because they were able to stimulate the MHC proteins to move to the surface with an immune stimulant. And so there is hope now that they could maybe prime the immune system with a vaccine so that the Tasmanian devils would be protected from this disease. Will that happen in time to save them from extinction? We certainly hope so. So what I've shown you is that this is a highly unusual disease, in that it is a contagious form of cancer, that it defies the normal immune barriers, and that it does so in a way that was not at all what was hypothesized even a year ago when I taught my tutorial on infectious disease. I think this story sort of underscores for me how rapidly a field like this is moving and how interesting it is, even though one might have thought initially that it was a rather esoteric topic. More generally, it shows the ways that molecular biologists and conservation biologists can work together to try to prevent the extinction of an entire species. And finally, I think it's really interesting to think about the trade-offs in the competition between a contagious agent like this infectious cancer and the host. If a cancer spreads so lethally and so rapidly that it kills off its hosts, then it will be gone as well. In the case of the dog venereal tumor, that cancer has evolved to not be that lethal. But that's taken thousands of years. Will the same thing happen to the devil facial tumor, given enough time? We don't know, and we may or may not have a chance to find out. Thank you.